For those of you who don't know me, I'm Rob Barton. I'm the co-director at the IS for the Faculty of Social Science and Health. And it's my pleasure to introduce Fabio Masacci from University of Trento, who's going to present some joint work with some others listed there on the slide. I won't read them out. And he's going to be talking about the role of catalogues of threats and security controls in security risk assessment, an empirical study with air traffic management professionals. It's a long title, Fabio.
Thank you.
Over to you.
So the one of the ideas that we had when we did the project in Durham was actually to look at the problem of air traffic control for volcanoes. So what people has to do when they have a safety problem. And this was a study that we have done some years ago, well, not very much, but on the issue of how do you do when you do a risk assessment in security, in particular for air traffic management people, which is one of the topics that will refer to the project that we are actually doing here for the advanced study. So let me give an example. So in which typically you have what one is ENAV. For instance, ENAV is a large air traffic management authority. They are the Italian one. They sometimes have new concepts. One new concept, for instance, is the remotely operated tower, which is a virtual tower, right? So is it you have an airport and you no longer have humans sitting there and watching planes going up and down. They only have videos and they put everything remotely. And this, of course, can create new security problems that you have no idea before because it's a new concept. Or you, for instance, an example in case of the volcano ashes will be the case that you send airplanes without pilots. And when you send airplanes without pilots, of course, you have a completely different problem that you need to completely pilot them remotely because you don't trust them going place with ashes or volcanoes, but then they become completely remote. And then things that can be completely remote can also be completely taken over by cybersecurity attacks. In some cases happened. I mean, the Iranians have been able to take over an American drone and crash it, but recover several things from there. And one of the problems that you have when you do in this area, you have lots of domain specialists, but very few security experts. And at this point, one solution is to say, okay, you know, we have lots of people that are expert in traffic control, but what are you gonna do? We're gonna have some people working on a risk-based methodology. There are lots of them which one are you gonna take it? So for instance, you can take the UK IS, IAS, which is a very short one. You can take the CSER SECRAM from Eurocontrol, which is a fork in an asset. The UK one, for instance, is very focused on threat. Let's protect it against the bad guy. While if you look at ISACA, for instance, which is a commercial audit organization, they focus more on business goal and so on. And to identify security measure, basically you have two alternatives, as I said, right? Suppose you have selected the methodology, then you need to actually, looking at the methodology, implement it and identify the security measure. You can ask security experts. They're expensive. There are very few of them. That we don't produce very many of them in terms of universities. Security is a very niche area. And the alternative, therefore, that many people have, so okay, this is your catalog. Take the book and follow it. And there are several of them. So for instance, the German BSI as a general security measure, and it's something like, I will say, like a British encyclopedia image that you have in your mind, right? Something like 7 volume. If you print it, it will go from left to right of a very big shelf in a library. The ISO 27002 is another example. It's also very long. The Eurocontrol risk toolkit instead is only a few hundred pages. So which one are you gonna choose, right? So if I look at the various methods, these are sentences they took from this method. You see, I find this fun it's very funny sentences here, like, why is a proven methodology for developing business-driven, risk and opportunity-focused at security architecture? Proven in which sense? And the other one that I like this, the aim and purpose of ZED is to analyze a proposed or existing system to identify risk, select appropriate controls to manage detectable risk. And if I ask you, place any of this sentence randomly in each of these volumes that are shown on the left, you will be very hard pressed to do so. Because I mean, all of them claim that they're super good. Right? So for instance, if you say Excel development in the balance, okay? All of them do the same thing, but how do you know which one works? Right? Because they all claim to work. So let me make an example to understand how big is that. So on one side, you have the German IP Grundschutz catalog. And introduction, 40 pages, like, you know, escalation, right? You go to assets, 350 pages. You go to control, you skyrocket to 3,000 pages. So basically factor 100. Gosh, it's a lot. If you look instead of Eurocontrol, it's a lot more management. ATMs for air traffic management. You have to specify this every time because I talk to UK people because they think this ATM is automatic teller machine. No, no, here ATM means air traffic management. The air traffic management toolkit is now much more manageable, something like 72 pages of controls. And if you look at the remotely operated towers scenario in which you want to apply these things, you have the operational focus error description is 100 pages. That simply describe how the things work. No security, no safety concern, just how the things plainly work. And you have to address security. And if, of course, if you can imagine if you have an airport, no more with human air traffic controllers on the flight, that you can look across the window to check that two planes are not crossing to each other while landing in the tarmac, then you need to have completely different things in terms of cameras and the remote videos and so on. So at the end, you can compress this to 24 pages, and then you have to decide which of the two. You use the German BSI, you use the Eurocontrol, which one works? And does it work any better? Does it help? So our idea that we wanted to experiment is, okay, we want to sort of identify an equivalent, right? And we have an equivalent in the literature, which is a, what is called a drug index. Because a drug index is something that most of physicians, they have on their desk, or now maybe it's online. If people come with a problem, they look at the drug index, they search the right guy and they give it to you. And we know well to evaluate how a physician can work with and without a drug index. And so we want to sort of do something similar. So if we give it security research index, security control index to a domain expert, do we have a methodology to test it, right? And we want to do this in a more scientific way than just saying, you know, drug inventor, so the research method inventor tested the research method and it works. Or I gave the drug to my students and they also feel great. And that's typically what happens. We give the methodology to our trainees that completed a very expensive security training and everything works fine because of course, nobody will ever says that you paid 20,000 pounds to run a security seminar for a ZACA course. I think it's 10,000 pounds for the basic course and for one people. And I think it's a little more for if you want to have the advanced course. So the idea is that we want to run an evaluation protocol and we want to run evaluation protocol in two ways. On one side, domain security expert without a catalog, and then domain expert with a generic catalog and with a specific catalog to understand if the catalogs really help. There has been several study in the, both in the setting of healthcare and in the, for instance, on transfer of studies from health knowledge in a structural form, and also in the business domain for structured knowledge in some ways, that seems to help. But it's not clear whether it really helps, for instance, another domain like security. And so this is the basic idea that we have. So can we evaluate it? So this is the basic idea of our experimental protocol from the perspective of analysis. So one side, we can have professional and master student. We can give them different scenarios. We can give different methods. In our case, the method one would be with catalogs, without catalogs, domain expert, not domain expert. We try to work them in some way. So I hope you can see my mouse, I'm not sure. And then we run an evaluation, both qualitative, for instance, with interviews, with a post-it session, and then we evaluate also the outcome. So once we give them a report with the catalog, do we get really the same kind of threats, or we get the lower quality threats, or we don't get any threats at all? And then we sort of measure, like we measure the background, we measure whether they lack the training, we measure what the first impression, and we also measure what's the final impression and the quality of the thing. And this may be a very big difference between the first impression and the final impression. So every catalog looks good until you have to look for things in it. And then it will come out what's really is the key point here. So let me explain how we did this. We first experimented with students. We have done a number of publications with students. Students have an advantage. So they are novices to the treatment. So they don't have a preconcept, a prejudice, let's say, of what works, right? They don't have a clue, which is good from a certain perspective. It is bad because they, of course, they're novices. And practitioners, they have a completely different opposite bias, because they know already what works. And if we tell them to work with something different, they may think, well, why make us waste our time in something that don't work? And both of the studies has been published in some papers here in the past. So the basic idea from our perspective is that the designer or the expert in the method, and possibly this should be different from the experimenter. So here in this case, we ask the security trainer from Eurocontrol that is several years experience in security and military security to actually give a training on the matter. And we collected customers from the scenario to evaluate, which was the same trainers in this group were actually evaluating the result. And the subject was that were practitioners, people with some time with 10 years of experience in air traffic management, but not security experts. Only very few of them were students. And the basic idea is to have why you want to have an independent evaluation was that, I mean, anybody can give a good matter, right? If you don't, if the things that you produce doesn't matter in terms of quality. We want a catalog. It's very easy to generate gazillions of security recommendations, right? You just take the page and then you go from number one to number 75 and you go down. And you list all of them and you're done. And this is, for instance, what happens with students. When we give them the catalog, they just keep doing a sort of what my professor in Cambridge called the British Library algorithm. You just go and list all the books in from the shelf, it's line one, line two, line three, line four, and you make a collection of all the interesting literature. But of course, it's not very high quality. And the thing is, of course, we expect that the expert in the matter is different than the expert in the domain, right? Now, so let me go about a little bit how this works. So first we train the participant. The designer trained on the method. So the designer trains on the Cesar Sacra method. The customers describe the scenario, in which case it was the remote tower. It was very important that this guy was not committed to this method, it was not for him. So it was not presenting, this is our method, it's important you get a good result with it. We needed to have the method applied for at least one day, because otherwise was not significant. In 1 hour, I remember, they're talking 24 pages for a short description. We are talking of catalogs in which at least 72 pages are the shortest one. The biggest one is actually 1,000 pages. It's not something in a process in 1 hour as a typical experiment that are run in social science or even engineering. You ask the student for 1 hour and see what happens. You cannot give any depth and complexity to that. It's very, very shallow. And then we ask an evaluation. So customers will evaluate the relevance of the results. So is this result relevant for remote tower security? And instead, the participant will evaluate the method is good or bad in terms of efficiency, effectiveness, right? So the one important thing that I always spot, we have two different measures. One is effectiveness and one is perceived efficacy and actual efficacy. So in terms of efficacy, we look at how the method is easy to use from our perspective and how we think the method is actually perceived to give good results. So there are two different things. Something can be easy to use, but deliver crappy results, and something can be hard to use but give good results. Okay, so there are two different dimensions, both efficacy in the sense, let's say, effort divided by time, so result divided by time, and effectiveness is instead quality of the results. And then the designer only evaluate the compliance, whether the students, in this case, the practitioner, follow the method. So what we did is essentially use a questionnaire, we do also some work group to identify. And then we have both a quantitative number of threats and controls and sort of a qualitative analysis. So let me go over what we have earlier. The first one is actual efficacy. So our null hypothesis was there's no difference between the treatment and risk and control. So whether you use a catalog or you don't, there's no difference. So security experts with the catalog should have no difference with the security expert with catalogs. Indeed, not right. It doesn't seem that this null hypothesis should be violated. So security experts should be better than the guys that have no security training, right? Perceived efficacy will be measured two different things, right? One, as I said, one is the perceived ease of use. So there's no difference between perceived efficacy in the sense the treatment is easy to use, right? No effort. And perceived usefulness is the second measure that I mentioned in a sense. Okay, the treatment will be effective, right? This catalog is good for us. And again, we use a questionnaire to evaluate the result. We didn't want to count the number of threats because as I said, with the catalog, it's very easy to get huge numbers simply by saying 1, 2, 3, select threats number 1, select threat number 75, and so on. But then it be completely unapplicable. So here, let me go at a little bit of the factor analysis. So if you see here all subjects on one side, if you look at the threats, and these are how the groups are distributed, that you see on the left, and the main catalog, so people with no catalog are security experts. And then a domain-specific catalog, you see that's actually much better, and the domain generic catalog out here. So you see here, the domain-specific catalog has actually been a slightly better there in terms of median score. And so expert means security expert. Right, so security expert with the catalog in terms of actual efficacy scored a little bit less than no expert, no security expert. Yeah? You are talking of people with 10 years or even more of experience in traffic control, but they didn't have any experience in security. And we gave them an APM catalog. And you see the catalog was better. There was no statistical difference if you look instead here, no catalog and domain generic catalog. Catalog was slightly worse to use. The perceived use of the people with no catalog were no problem. in terms of the median score. So what does tell us? Okay, so the important things that they emerge from the qualitative analysis are two interesting things. Ask Quentin to stop me at any point. So the first one that emerged, why we came with this strange difference. So the expert has no catalog. They just applied the methodology and said, well, we can do it without a catalog. We don't need it. You see, four is actually better than three. It's sort of inversion here. While in terms of perception, the no expert were actually able to do it slightly better. So the first thing that emerged from the qualitative analysis was that from a perspective of the important things of the quality, the first thing that is said in the non-expert, the fact that you have been able to navigate through the catalog is there to help you navigate it, to find the right things. And instead, if you look at the non-expert, you see this sentence here was actually something reported by the non-expert. It will simply say, oh, look, you know, they were not able to find stuff in the catalog. They kept getting lost, they kept browsing it, didn't find anything. And other says, okay, look, once you identify the threads, the other one was just browsing and finding mechanical work, no intellectual complexity. So we can see here that structure and navigation are very important for non-experts. While for experts, the most important things was, we look at domain experts. We look at the things, and then we look at the catalog just to find out we didn't miss anything. We just brainstorm on our own head, and then we say, oh, maybe something is missing. Let's check if it's there, that could be forgotten. So that's the use completely in the things in a completely different way. So everybody using them of a common language and as a checklist. But that's what's the interesting thing between the expert and the non-expert. So expert will use it as a common language, and non-expert instead will use it to find things. But then it emerged that the bigger it is, the more complicated it is to use it. So let me go to the summary of the experiment, and then we can ask ourselves, do catalogs work? The answer is maybe yes, because we would find out the non-expert perform, not in security expert, but domain experts, okay? Let me always stress this. Perform equally well to expert without catalogs. But what we find out was also that you need to have a domain-specific catalogs. If you give the people just the same people with 10 years of experience in air traffic management, you give them a generic security catalogs, they're not gonna do well. They're gonna do poorly. And the important thing is that it came out, they use them in a completely different way. Expert will look at the catalog to check that something is not forgotten, while non-expert will look to find something. So if you give them a generic catalog, they will not be able to find this something. There's additional things that are interesting. So for instance, how are we able to put it as a future work, for a future interesting work? So one is, of course, the comprehensibility of the results. Because of course, once you have a result, you need to pipe this to some people in higher management, or you have to pipe it down to the people in terms of operational implementation. The question is the catalog helping in the steps? And this was actually a key point from the stakeholders, because they really said, when we interviewed various people, it's really important that the result can be then passed on for somebody that's gonna implement them, because otherwise it's useless. And in this perspective, the role of the catalog can be even higher. I can imagine the healthcare, like, okay, you not only have a drug index, now I don't know the name in English, this little leaflet that's attached to the various drugs that tells you what are the side effects or the various things. So you may want to have that, because this is gonna help the people that deploy the things in the field to understand what they're doing. And one of the things that we would really like to do, but that's very expensive, is to have a real, really large assessment of several hours. maybe a day or 2 days, because in real life, a risk assessment normally either is 5 minutes or 15 minutes, like it check boxes, okay, that's okay, that's not a security risk, or it goes to a high risk. The first 15 minutes determines the high risk, and then it goes into a different pipe in which maybe several days will be spent analyzing it. So that's really the trick that we need to have really an experiment, so being able to do it. What happens if it's really several days of work? So it's either 15 minutes, quick and dirty, decide whether it goes into no problem or into maybe it's a big problem, and then it takes days. And with this, I'm done with the presentation. And so thank you all for your time. But maybe we can have some question or a discussion for this.
Thank you very much. It's not an area that I am familiar with myself, so this might be a very naive question. But maybe I've misunderstood the whole purpose of what you're trying to do, but is this not an area where, you know, really we're going to be uploading our cognitive processes into artificial intelligence more? Is this what you've described, a sort of old tech approach in that sense, or have I got the wrong end of the stick?
I wish we will be able to dump this on AI approaches, but I'm afraid they won't. Because at the end of the day, you want a human to take responsibility for what, if they decided whether there's a risky process or not. And therefore, we'll still have humans in the loop. And so what we are actually interested in is how the human will use this information to actually make a decision. What people will use the AI for, if I understand correctly your question, for this security decision, is typically they use the AI to collect some data about, to do machine learning, to do statistics of things that happen and don't happen, and then pass this to the expert who will do something with it.
Yeah.
But then essentially what I'm interested in is understanding what the expert are going to do with it. In the same way that we can pass to a climate change scientists, and that lots of data, and then they're going to conclude that, okay, maybe it's going to raise by 2 Celsius or 0.5 Celsius or 3.5 Celsius. But how do you know? And in this case, it's actually more, let's say, measurable, because it's a lot more difficult to measure whether the prediction and of the climate scientists, because they are so far in the future, 2 Celsius in 40 years, Paul, okay. But here it's easier to predict, because we are talking of a much more operational recommendation, what you're gonna do. And that's where having a, understanding exactly whether some type of support will help them. The people from Eurocontrol that I mentioned it, they actually have implemented a sort of an automatic checkpoint and suggesting what you should do in certain cases. Not very machine learning approach, but more sort of a assistant things. But then still at the end, eventually they find out that it's a bit unreliable. They don't have enough data. That's also one of the problems of security. They do not have much data on thermo. The attacks are normally very rare.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask a question about cultural context? Because your methodology is very kind of monolithic in terms of how it thinks about people. But I would have thought that risk assessment would be very heavily dependent on cultural context, and also particularly on relationships between parties. I mean, one of the things I found working on water issues is that people trust the quality of water and the levels of risks attached to it. largely upon the quality of their relationships with its their suppliers, rather than on the kind of objective methodologies that you're describing. So I wonder if your work can encompass any way sort of cultural differences and relational differences through which people approach these things.
It's a good question. So what we, well, at a certain point, we went out to interviews to make focus groups with a number of different people from different nationalities. So interviewing people from France, for instance, the UK, other places in Europe and so on. What I find important and so on. This was less, let me say, because they used, let me expand a little bit, especially in the air traffic and the aviation community, there is a sort of common idea that you should justify your opinion. No, not your opinion, let's say your findings. Okay, this is something like, for instance, for safety, you have to make a case for safety. Even for environmental pollution, you have to make a case for safety, for economic, for not for pollution, for environmental saving and so on. And therefore, they do not, in a sense, they tend to not, so I say, they tend to evaluate things a little bit at the object level. For what regard the case, the trust aspect may depend on, did you actually tell us everything or not? Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this was actually the point. So are you actually economic with it? I think there's a British have this very great expression that is being economic with the truth. Mm-hmm. And so the real question is that in some cases they think, well, okay, maybe they're not telling us everything here. So especially if in terms of the partner with whom they have to do, right? So they tend to see, okay, if only civil matter are in place, we assume that most of the people will tell everything. And in other cases, they will assume that they will not tell us everything. So for instance, they will not trust the American to say, be completely truthful with the truth if Boeing is involved. And the same way they will not trust the French if Airbus is involved.
Yep.
Okay. But otherwise, it's okay. Mm-hmm. Right? So because the assumption is that you will have to make the case and justify the thing. And a little bit more. One big difference that we see for security, it really not depend on the nationality, but also on the different type of background that you have. I mentioned in the beginning that we have these different catalogs. So for instance, the UK one, the information assurance catalog, this has been derived by, now I never have the right ordering of letter. So it is GCHQ. I mean, you know it, right? You know the sequence. I always have the wrong, the C and the Q in the wrong order, but you know what I mean. And so this is a very strong focus on threats. So it starts from the threats, identify the bad guys, move from there. Whereas aviation or Eurocontrol, their idea is goals. So business goal, we want to keep aircraft separation. We want to keep the aircraft different, separated, so they don't crash into each other. We want to keep as many flights in the area as possible. So their focus is, these are our goal. And so we have to work towards this goal. Whereas the UK, because it's been derived by this agency, as a focus of, we want to protect against the bad guy. And the other one is, we want to make sure that flies stay in the area. So they really start in a different way. Eventually they should come at a different conclusion. And for instance, the UK, the US NIST, which has been sort of in between, there's been a strong push from the NSA or the DHS as a strong push of threat. But that's sort of the two elements, the assets and the threats are sort of same level. Whereas, as I said, the UK is really threat first. And the air traffic management is assets first, threat come later. And so this will also give a different conversation when you talk to the people. Also, when you do an analysis, they will really start saying, oh, the really important thing is to make sure that this happen. And the other guy will say, no, no, the really important thing is to make sure that, I don't know, you don't have a friend or foe mishap. While the others are less worried about this, for instance. Mm-hmm. So from answering your question, the context, there is a different thing in terms of context. This depends from the background of the people, where they come from, more than the nationality. Mm-hmm. Right? So the French method, which has also been done by ANSI, which is the equivalent of the UK GHCQ, or that one, has the same feature. So the fact that one is French, the other is UK, is no difference. And the NIST is very close to the Eurocontrol, because they came from the same civilian background. So you can see military background, irrespective of nationality, civilian background, irrespective of nationality. And then I said, is this close to a manufacturer? So that they may be not so, let's say, willing to disclose everything, as I said, mm-hmm. in terms of the case for security or the case for safety. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. That was a very full answer, Fabio, and I'm sure you must be other questions.
Well, I didn't have a question, but I had a discussion point, which was that obviously the previous work that I guess you've done and we've done has been very much focused on terrorism and cyber. And, you know, as we were thinking about extending it out to more general aviation risks, and obviously in discussion with the Red, how do you see the difference between these kind of like, I don't know what the best way of putting it, low frequency, high impact events, you know, like COVID, like volcanic eruptions, you know, closing airspaces. Does that have a significant difference in terms of the comparison with sort of general levels of aviation risk, which, you know, has generally been on safety and reliability and, you know, terrorism and security?
It's a good question. I think certain things are close. Other things are slightly different. So let me answer of the things that are close. So one of the things that are close is the fact that you're sort of predicting rare events. And the rare events that may not happens. And therefore you have all the problem that how do you actually predict the threats? Mm. So how do you actually predict or decide which threat in terms, for instance, of volcano ashes, that the motors will fail, right? So you can still afford the risk of having the plane lifting. And also because in the same way as in security, you have different actors playing the game, right? Because from the perspective of the airlines, you want to keep as many airlines, as many planes in the air, because you don't make money if they're not flying. From the perspective of the safety in the states, if a plane fails, is seen not only as a failure of the airline, is also seen as a failure of the regulator. And so this is different things that the regulator don't want to see as failed in their oversight capacity. It's somehow strangely that it's less seen as a failure of the manufacturer. It's more seen as a failure of the FAA. So for instance, if you look at the recent Boeing Max example, the damage to Boeing was less than the damage to the FAA. The reputational damage to, I mean, it's the task of Boeing to ship aircraft. They shipped a faulty aircraft, fine. But the damage to the FAA was much larger because they failed to do the oversight like this. And therefore, for instance, normally, as, just to give you an example how big was the failure, normally there is an agreement between the various regulators that if something is certified in a country, it's automatically accepted as in another.
Yeah.
Now, if you think this is a rare event, but then the European Union has said, we not accept anymore the FAA, so they landed the Boeing MAX, even though the FAA says was still fit to fly. Never happened. Okay. So this is really something is a failure for the regulator. You can imagine in the COVID vaccine that people will say, we normally accept the FAA conclusion on whether a FDA conclusion on whether a vaccine is good or not. And then they said, we're not gonna do this. And they always did in the past. Okay, so in terms of the failure of reputation, it's a lot worse hit for the FAA than it's for Boeing, okay? So in terms of the general rare event, the role of the regulator is sort of more vulnerable to if one of this bad event goes badly. And also from the perspective of, if you want to run similar case studies for a project, an interesting question would be, what would be the take on the regulator? So for instance, let me say, in Indonesia, you can normally fly. Indonesian approaches to aircraft security, it's a lot lighter. So you can fly things. But normally all Indonesian air carrier are in the European Union blacklist.
Yeah. I mean, there is a lot of tradition, though, in varying. I mean, you know, you can imagine, for example, in closed aerospace situations, you might have a situation where, for example, the United States has, you know, a different risk tolerance to Europe in that way. I mean, we have seen that in different experiences. I mean, you know, particularly when you've got variability in terms of some sort of control variable. So I mean, ash would be the one where, you know, you have concentrations and the European directive says it's got to be zero, and the Americans might have, well, do have a different, have a higher tolerance given the level of there. But I mean, you know, but then as you say, in contrast, the Americans are typically extremely risk averse when it comes to, terrorism type threats. And that has a sort of a slightly different sort of take on it, which I think is kind of interesting from the interaction with the engineering. And in what level of reassurance do you require from the engineering front when you have a variable risk? And because these things are so far towards, you know, the origin in terms of the probability of effect, you know, the difference between a 1 in 100,000 and a 1 in 2, you know, 500,000 or a 1 in 1 million, effectively from an experiential point of view is the same. But when you then have, I don't know, you know, 400,000-500,000 flights, you know, then you start to see some issues in terms of, like, you know, your two law of large numbers begin to cancel. So it's I think it's an open research question, because, you know, we see with COVID, for example, opening up of airlines in terms of, like, you know, as a different risk factor and extending the out. And, you know, I'm not sure we ever fully solved the, you know, what level of terrorist threat. I mean, when we went to Turkey, for example, it was a different, you know, they have a much different tolerance to risk in Istanbul than they had in Anadolu, didn't they? So even within country, there are some differences of opinion in terms of the threat vectors. That would be reasonable to say, isn't it?
Yeah. I also believe that, for instance, in Iceland, they have some idea what it takes to live with volcanoes, and the same way is for Indonesia, right? So they have a slightly different tolerance that we have. And I think here the interesting thing is what the regulator is going to take. And let me say something for COVID was a good example. It's an anecdote. It's nothing to do with air traffic control. But since I have board an affiliation in Amsterdam and Trento, at a certain point, I had the privilege of seeing, I don't know if it's a privilege, but of seeing different measure for Christmas. And it was a very, very interesting idea of that in theory is the illness is the same, the pandemic is the same. And then you see, and since I live near close to Austria in Italy, I will see four, Germany, Italy, Austria, and Netherlands and Belgium. And then I know from Julian, so I knew what was the UK was, and says, well, you know, boys, we're talking about the same thing. How can you have so many different rules? I mean, the really rules, not that a human guy could see as a, they're clearly not the same thing. Are you talking of the same illness?
Yeah, no. the variety of responses in that one is like, it's pretty bad, isn't it? In that sort of way.
Yeah, but the same thing is in a sense, because there was no clear idea what the real risk was.
Yeah, yeah.
We're talking of something that, even though we have an idea, we have no clear understanding of what the real risk was. Because we are now taking over, we're now certain things for which we have measure, because we never had the pandemics in the past of this size, so we never have a really an idea of what the risk will be. And therefore, we don't have an idea what the measure will work. And we cannot run experiments to say, okay, let's try to have some flights going on over the ashes and see if the passengers drop dead. It's not gonna be a good idea. And therefore, we probably have a different response here in this case as well, because we don't have a good idea yet of what works. And we'll need to have some natural experiments at which we can say, okay, this very rare things will have a better idea in the future. As a retrospective analysis, I would say.
Yeah, I don't know enough about this to form a question. It's more like it may be a question too, but it's philosophical in some ways. I actually worked on countering violent extremism programs, but it's so entirely different that there were these two silos, basically, with a social scientist working on what Veronica called cultural context, and ferreting out these narratives that supposedly cause people to engage in extremism. And then the Department of Defense usually engaged in a lot of something that looks very familiar from your work. So I'm just wondering, this is following up on Veronica, I believe, but how these two streams can be somehow combined to make for a greater greater degree of accuracy in risk assessment, because obviously there are so many factors in the social and cultural context that can't really be accounted for that accurately.
So I'll answer to this, because I mean, Veronica may want to chip in as well, but one of the things that we as engineers are very bad is actually seeing the pictures of complexity. So for me, for this stream to converge, we will need on one side something more like, okay, you're telling us that the things are very complex. Stereotype. Can you give us one or two things that we can measure? As I'm stereotyping both role of the spectrum. But I think here one of the difficulties is that we need to find something that can be sort of measured in a more technical sense. Because then one can say, okay, we have these this approach that then can be tested in some way. And I think here, maybe if we start thinking of case control studies, I believe that case control studies are the way in which the two disciplines can talk to each other. Case studies are too far from the let's say, the mentality of the engineers, and at the same time, a replicable experiment may be too far from the social scientists because they simplify everything and give me two variables. Mm-hmm. So probably case control study will be something in which the two, let's say, world can talk to each other.
Veronica, please, were you starting to say something?
Well, no, you go first, but I was going to chip in a little bit there.
Well, I just briefly, one tool that we tried to develop, and I'm not so sure the results were particularly good, but it was a psychological tool, integrative complexity, scoring, to take a group of people and determine what sort of proclivities they might have towards extremist thinking. But that's the only thing I can think of that actually could be somewhat quantified, and I'm not sure that it works very well, but okay, Veronica.
Yeah, I was going to jump all over Fabio for being defeatist about the potential for engineers and anthropologists to work together usefully, because actually I think that some in-depth case studies would be very complementary in some ways to what you're doing, because I think they would get at some of the key factors. But I am very cognizant of the problem. In my early career, I worked with computer agent-based modelers, and they were very much like what you just said, Fabio. Just give me 5 key variables. Don't do anything else, please. But actually, when we did the ethnographic work, looking at how people managed energy and so forth, it did actually feed into their thinking on this. So I'd like to say be very much more optimistic about the potential, and having written various projects with anthropologists and engineers, it's not impossible. And I would think about a couple of key things that you might want to investigate via case studies. And that would be things like, I mean, I mentioned levels of trust earlier, and that is something that's relatively comparable and measurable across groups. And also I picked up on what you said about the Norwegians' view of this, because they have so much more knowledge of living with volcanoes and so forth. And I actually think that finding out how much people know about things is quite useful. So I don't know how measurable that is, but it would strike me as being quite an important factor in their capacity to weigh and imagine risks. Because where it really, a risk is an article of imagination. You know, how we imagine the model, how we imagine what might happen with stuff floating in the air or whatever. And so I think getting at what they really understand about the problem would be quite telling. But above all, I would simply encourage you to risk getting in there with anthropologists and talking about the complexities that really your methodology doesn't encompass.
So if I can follow up a little bit on what Sandra says on the idea of why people become, so you have a special, basically a sort of, I would say, questionnaire or something similar, if I understand correctly, for identifying extremists. Okay, so how people will verge towards extremists. Oh, this may be something interesting, because we can use it for completely different things, that's hacking. But one of the things that I think is important, in which anthropologists could actually help engineer, is magic. It seems something strange, but then there's a very famous, I think as a UK author, is a Clark, Arthur Clark. And as a, he said that any technology that's sufficiently complex is indistinguishable from magic. And this is one of the important things that we need to have, what is called a folk model of how technology work. Because many of the air traffic incidents are actually due from a wrong understanding on how the technology worked. So people created a mental model of how the technology worked, or how they think the technology work. And what we sometimes call the folk security model. People have a certain belief that, okay, these things work in a certain way that's completely different from how things actually work inside. And then when something happens, because they have this wrong model of how things happen inside, then lots of other things happen, as sometimes air traffic incidents, because people has a certain assumption how things will work and will react, or even computer security incidents, they are also due to this failure in which normal user or even operators believe that their technology works. And so this idea of understanding how do you think that the technology works is more or less could be something similar that one could use in the study that you look at how the people verge toward a certain belief of how the bad and the good guys and so on could also be used to understand what kind of belief that people develop on the way which technology works. Mm-hmm. So this, I think, will be an interesting area to work on, so to sort of understand, okay, how can we use the anthropologist's idea of, say, creating a picture of people's belief to extracting the same picture from the users that people have of their technology, because sometimes it's very close to magic. As the same idea that we'll explore that people believe in magic, in which everything is connected, and maybe people think that something is connected in a way that is not, and in reality is connected in another way that they don't think is possible.
Mm-hmm. So this, have you ever heard of Alfred Gell's work on the enchantment of technology? It touches on just exactly what you're talking about, which is the way that people have quite magical thinking about technology, that they imagine it in very, often very creative ways that may have absolutely nothing to do, but they're also awed by the expertise and capacities of people who really do understand it. So that technology becomes enchanting because it does seem to be kind of magical in its functioning. So if you want to get really subtle about the notion of magic in technology, Alfred Gell, it's great stuff. And there's also people writing about it, like Penny Harvey, when it comes to infrastructure, how that achieves kind of magical thinking in terms
okay.
of how
to okay.
Yeah, could be fun for you.
Yeah.
I had a small comment on the, I mean, Fabio, correct me if I'm wrong, but Martina is an anthropologist, wasn't she?
Yes, she was.
Yeah,
yes.
She is an anthropologist, yeah. So, because I mean, the only thing I would say is we did look a lot in the past, some years ago, actually longer ago than I'd like to remember, but about looking at things like analysis of behavioral patterns. I think the trouble is, of course, is that there's an endogeneity to how, you know, the testing versus the analysis. And the mechanism of assessing whether somebody, you know, exhibits a series of traits within a particular fixed and static coding. And what you find is over time, you develop more and more false positives. And, you know, you have things like the prosecutor's problem, where the more you look at somebody, the more you think that person's dodgy. And the more evidence you have, because you have a myriad of collections of evidence, and then you begin to sift through and you then collect more and more evidence to suggest that person has a predisposition, for example, to extremism. And the algorithm, you know, particularly machine learning algorithms, looking at things like social media posts and stuff like that, because I mean, we have spent a lot of time looking at this and interested in this. And, you know, they're called greedy algorithms, you know, machine learning greedy algorithms for doing these sorts of typifications. And no matter how much you get a psychologist or even clinical psychiatrists to kind of direct it, having a static regime often results just in large numbers of false positives, because it just looks for the trait. And, you know, in some respects, you can have people with very similar responses to this will actually then have very different outcomes when it comes to the exposure to different types of media and things like that, for which an engineering solutions are much more difficult. And it's actually better probably to look at understanding action. You know, if somebody's buying up a third of the UK supply of peroxide, they're probably building a bomb. So, you know, that these are things that you can actually figure out from actual action rather than actually from things like what they're reading, what they're inferring, that sorts of things. And I think that's the bit where I always get a bit nervous, because the machine learning algorithms they don't, you know, and this comes back all the way back to the decision making, the first question that was asked, which was like, how isn't this, shouldn't this just be delegated to, you know, our artificial intelligence overlords? And the answer is none of the machine learning algorithms that we have can embody any of the kinds of general levels of ethics, understanding, appropriateness, that sorts of things in terms of action, and understand the endogeneity of action. In other words, when you do something, you're in, you know, if I ask you a question which leads you to believe that you're asking me about a certain track of train of ideas, this will lead to a reciprocation, which may be I might then, you know, find that my algorithm is pursuing more aggressively. So I think that's a concern I would have. And that's where the I think the magic comes in as well, in terms of the engineering side of these things. So there's always a necessariness for the human condition to be taken into account with that, and the endogeneity of the action that's there. You know, we looked at security guards and motivations for, you know, identification of terrorists. And, you know, we found some awfully strange things about how they reacted to training. You know, you'd say, you know, they would spend a lot of time trying to persuade people to be more patriotic and things like that. But actually, the thing that really motivated them was things that built up their human capital over time. And that's what got them more engaged with actually identifying threats and looking at things like this. And so these are the sorts of things that are worth while sort of thinking about. I mean, you know, the one that always sticks with me was remember the knives thing in Heathrow, when they switched over to, they have a sort of performance related pay for finding stuff. And when they switched over to finding bottles, then they would regularly find people would leave like cutlery in their bags when they took it through the scanners. And so there would be a regular churn week on week of cutlery going through the scanners, and they identify the cutlery. And that's just an accident. So this is an exogenous process, just people leaving knives and forks in their bags. Happens on average a certain number of times with a bit of variability each week. Once you went to bottles, they stopped finding knives. Now the question then, what they're finding was, is that it's not that knives weren't being left in bags. It's just that the people who were looking for the stuff were now looking for bottles, and they stopped finding the knives. So the key point about it is none of these things, you know, every time you run an action, you always have a reaction to it. And there's a psychology on behalf of those that you're looking to understand threat and threat action against. And there's the psychology of people who are actually engaged in running an opposition to this. And these are non-trivial things to model in a way, and often have to be modeled at an engagement basis. But, you know, I think just sort of wanted to make that sort of little point, because it's just, you know, there's a lot of nuance to the kind of work that's been done over the last, you know, 15 years, believe it or not. Is it 15? No, it's not quite 15 years, Fabio. It's 13, 14 years, isn't it? So, you know, that's sort of things there.
Just to say thanks very much to Fabio once again for obviously what's turned into a really thought-provoking talk.